Simon & Schuster Audio presents Teacher Man, a Memoir by Frank McCourt. Read by the author.
Prologue. If I knew anything about Sigmund Freud and psychoanalysis, I'd be able to trace all my troubles to my miserable childhood in Ireland. That miserable childhood deprived me of self-esteem, triggered spasms of self-pity, paralyzed my emotions, made me cranky and envious and disrespectful of authority, retarded my development, crippled my doings with the opposite sex, kept me from rising in the world and made me unfit, almost, for human society. How I became a teacher at all and remain one is a miracle, and I have to give myself full marks for surviving all those years in the classrooms of New York. There should be a medal for people who survive miserable childhoods and become teachers, and I should be the first in line for the medal, on whatever bars might be appended for ensuing miseries. I could lay blame. The miserable childhood doesn't simply happen. It is brought about. There are dark forces. If I am to lay blame, it is in a spirit of forgiveness. Therefore, I forgive the following. Pope Pius XII, the English in general, and King George VI in particular. Cardinal McRory, who ruled Ireland when I was a child. The Bishop of Limerick, who seemed to think everything was sinful. Eamon de Valera, former Prime Minister, Taoiseach, and President of Ireland. Mr. de Valera was a half-Spanish Gaelic fanatic, Spanish onion in an Irish stew, who directed teachers all over Ireland to beat the native tongue into us and natural curiosity out of us. He caused us hours of misery. He was aloof and indifferent to the black and blue welts raised by schoolmaster sticks on various parts of our young bodies. I forgive also the priest who drove me from the confessional when I admitted to sins of self-abuse and self-pollution and penny thieveries from my mother's purse. He said I did not show a proper spirit of repentance, especially in the matters of the flesh. And even though he hit that nail right on the head, his refusal to grant me absolution put my soul in such peril that if I'd been flattened by a truck outside the church, he would have been responsible for my eternal damnation. I forgive various bullying schoolmasters for pulling me out of my seat by the sideburns, for walloping me regularly with stick, strap, and cane when I stumbled over answers in the catechism or when, in my head, I couldn't divide 937 by 739. I was told by my parents and other adults it was all for my own good. I forgive them for those whopping hypocrisies and wonder where they are at this moment. Heaven? Hell? Purgatory, if it still exists. I can even forgive myself, though when I look back at various stages of my life, I groan. What an ass. What timidities, what stupidities, what indecisions and flounderings. But then I take another look. I had spent childhood and adolescence examining my conscience and finding myself in a perpetual state of sin. That was the training, the brainwashing, the conditioning, and it discouraged smugness, especially among the sinning class. Now I think it's time to give myself credit for at least one virtue, doggedness. Not as glamorous as ambition or talent or intellect or charm, but still the one thing that got me through the days and nights. F. Scott Fitzgerald said that in American lives, there are no second acts. He simply did not live long enough. And in my case, he was wrong. When I taught in New York City high schools for 30 years, no one but my students paid me a scrap of attention. In the world outside the school, I was invisible. Then I wrote a book about my childhood and became Mick of the Moment, I hoped the book would explain family history to McCourt children and grandchildren. I hoped it might sell a few hundred copies and I might be invited to have discussions with book clubs. Instead, it jumped on the bestseller list and was translated into 30 languages, and I was dazzled. The book was my second act. In the world of books, I'm a late bloomer, a Johnny-come-lately, new kid on the block. My first book, Angela's Ashes, was published in 1996 when I was 66. The second, Tis, in 1999 when I was 69. At that age, it's a wonder I was able to lift the pen at all. New friends of mine, recently acquired because of my ascension to the bestseller list, had published books in their 20s. Striplings. So, what took you so long? I was teaching, that's what took me so long. Not in college or university where you have all the time in the world for writing and other diversions, but in four different New York City public high schools. I've read novels about the lives of university professors where they seem to be so busy with adultery and academic infighting, you wonder where they found time to squeeze in a little teaching. When you teach five high school classes a day, 5 days a week, you're not inclined to go home to clear your head and fashion deathless prose. After a day of five classes, your head is filled with the clamor of the classroom. I never expected Angela's Ashes to attract any attention, but when I hit the bestseller list, I became a media darling. I had my picture taken hundreds of times. I was a geriatric novelty with an Irish accent. I was interviewed for dozens of publications. I met governors, mayors, actors. I met the first President Bush and his son, the governor of Texas. I met President Clinton and Hillary Rodham Clinton. I met Gregory Peck. I met the Pope and kissed his ring. Sarah, Duchess of York, interviewed me. She said I was her first Pulitzer Prize winner. I said she was my first duchess. She said, ooh, and asked the cameraman, did you get that? Did you get that? I was nominated for a Grammy for the spoken word and nearly met Elton John. People looked at me in a different way. They said, oh, you wrote that book. This way, please, Mr. McCourt. Or is there anything you'd like? Anything. A woman in a coffee shop squinted and said, I seen you on TV. You must be important. Who are you? Could I have your autograph? I was listened to. I was asked for my opinion on Ireland, conjunctivitis, drinking, teeth, education, religion, adolescent angst, William Butler Yeats, literature in general. What books are you reading this summer? What books have you read this year? Catholicism, writing, hunger. I spoke to gatherings of dentists, lawyers, ophthalmologists, and of course, teachers. I travel the world being Irish, being a teacher, an authority on misery of all kinds, a beacon of hope to senior citizens everywhere who always wanted to tell their stories. They made a movie of Angela's Ashes. No matter what you write in America, there is always talk of the movie. You could write the Manhattan telephone directory and they'd say, so, when is the movie? If I hadn't written Angela's Ashes, I would have died begging. Just one more year, God, just one more year, because this book is the one thing I want to do in my life, what's left of it. I never dreamed it would be a bestseller. I hoped it would sit on bookseller shelves while I lurked in the bookshop and watched beautiful women turn pages and shed the occasional tear. They'd buy the book, of course, take it home, loll on divans, and read my story while sipping herbal tea or a fine sherry. They'd order copies for all their friends. In Tis, I wrote about my life in America and how I became a teacher. After it was published, I had the nagging feeling I'd given teaching short shrift. In America, doctors, lawyers, generals, actors, television people, and politicians are admired and rewarded, not teachers. Teaching is the downstairs maid of professions. Teachers are told to use the service door or go around the back. They are congratulated on having ATTO, all that time off. They're spoken of patronizingly and patted retroactively on their silvery locks. Oh, yes, I had an English teacher, Miss Smith, who really inspired me. I'll never forget dear old Miss Smith. She used to say that if she reached one child in her 40 years of teaching, it would make it all worthwhile. She'd die happy. The inspiring English teacher then fades into grey shadows to eke out her days on a penny-pinching pension, dreaming of the one child she might have reached. Dream on, teacher. You will not be celebrated. You think you'll walk into the classroom?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.